There are some areas of our life where we can readily identify, I need God to make something new. I need hope or help with my faith, or maybe my marriage, or with my kids, or with my parents, or with my friends, with something. And a lot of times we want things to change, but we're not sure if they really can. And so what I want to ask you to do today, and if you could be here for 5 weeks in this series, is what if this is really what God does? He takes things that seem lost and he can make them found. And he takes things that seem dead and he can make them alive. If he can take things that seem old and make them new. What if this is what he does? So my dad was, I guess he still is, he's retired, was an architect his whole life. And so I grew up around construction sites. And it was amazing for me to see where something was there, like a field, and all of a sudden then a building was there. Or he did some work in downtown Dallas where there was an old rundown building that had been quite run down for a long time. We walked past it all the time, and somehow they asked my dad to do this, and he saw this old building and said, what if we could make it new? And it became this life, alive and vibrant building. And it was awesome to see that and be around that. And I believe that can happen with buildings. We believe it can happen with houses, right? I mean, Chip and Joanna Gaines do it all the time if you ever watch the show Fixer Upper. They take people to see these three houses. Here's three choices, and all of them look bad. And usually the people kind of go, I don't know. And they go, we see something here. And then they kind of say, here's what we might do with it. It's usually involves shiplap and subway tile and an island in the kitchen. And they have this vision for it. And they take it and they do it. And then there's demo day where everything is busted down. And then they fix it, they renovate it, they make it new, they fixer-upper it, and then there's the big reveal. Many of us think the big reveal of what our lives could be isn't always that hopeful. But what if it is? Do you know, and this isn't in the notes, so you might want to write this down, Revelation 21:9, Jesus says, behold, I'm making all things new. He says that at the end of the story that never ends, eternity. He says, I am making all things new. He didn't say it at the beginning. He said at the end, because he says it all the way through, that God is always at work. Here's what I believe about every single one of you. You are created on purpose. And you are created for a purpose. And every single day of your life, God is working with purpose in your life and around you. What we want to do over the next 5 weeks is talk about what are some choices that we can make because of the choices God made to make us new and to bring new life to these situations. If you have your Bibles, turn to John chapter 5, and we're going to focus a lot on the idea that God is in this business of making things new. And sometimes it's helpful to see some examples, and we're going to see several examples in this. And anytime you read in the Gospels, Gospel of Mark, or Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, here's a helpful way to study the Bible on your own. When you read a story, an episode, an encounter in the day in the life of Jesus, put yourself in the story. What would it be like if you were there? Put yourself as a participant, like Jesus is interacting with you, or even put yourself as a spectator, that you're watching all this happen, and then kind of try and picture it and ask questions about it. What do you notice about it? What's happening here? But when you put yourself in the story, it helps you see the story. But the other thing you need to know is you are placed in God's story because he's your creator. And he wants to be your redeemer. And so how he interacts with others is an indication of how he will interact with us. And in John chapter 5, you see the story that actually has some questions in it that raises in my mind that I'd like to share with you. In verse 1, it says this, sometime later, Jesus went up to Jerusalem for one of the Jewish festivals. Here's why this is important. There's not always dates in the Gospels. In fact, there's usually not. But what there are is it says Jesus did this. And so we know that Jesus went to at least three Passovers. And so if this festival was a Passover, there were several different festivals. It changes. Maybe his ministry was more than 3 years. If it was only three, it's probably three-ish. And so anyway, this is a festival he's going to. And so it gives us an idea. This was a real day in history. There was a festival going on. John remembered. When was that? Oh, yeah, it was at this date. And John remembers about the season it was. Now, there in Jerusalem, near the sheep gate, a pool which in Aramaic is called Bethesda, which is surrounded by five covered colonnades. Here, a great number of disabled people used to lie, the blind, the lame, and the paralyzed. So he tells us there's all these people that would gather at this one gate. And they would be there. And so if you're reading this and you put yourself in the story, you kind of maybe ask, why do they hang out at this place? Do they just like being by the pool? Is there some kind of purpose to this? And so verse 4 may or may not be in your Bible. It may actually be a footnote. But verse 4 reads this way. They waited there for the moving of the waters. From time to time, an angel of the Lord would come down and stir up the waters. The first one into the pool, after each disturbance, would be cured of whatever disease they had. Now, most likely, a scribe who was transcribing John's gospel decided, when they read this story, they're going to have no idea what's going on. Kind of like if somebody from England all of a sudden heard everybody saying, guns up, they'd say, well, they're Texans, it kind of makes sense, but I'm not sure if I know what that means. Oh, at Texas Tech, that has some meaning. See, this was something that locals would know about that they wondered, I'm not sure if they're going to understand this. And so he inserts a little comment here. This is why I believe in the integrity of the Bible. Because when there's something they're not sure about, there's an asterisk. There's a footnote. Earliest manuscripts don't support this. We're not sure how it got here. But this gives us some insight and understanding into kind of what was going on. So out of this huge crowd, Jesus spots one person. One who was there had been an invalid for 38 years, almost 40 years. This person had not been mobile. They had not been moving. They had been stuck. So he was in the right crowd that day. And Jesus, for whatever reason, stops and interacts with him. There's no indication that this person reached out to Jesus or said anything or raised his hand, or we don't know why, but Jesus picks this one guy out of many to ask this question. He says this in verse 6. When Jesus saw him lying there and learned that he had been in this condition for a long time, he asked him, "Do you want to get well?" Does that seem like a ridiculous question? I mean, that's why people gathered there. Do you want to get well? Here's the strange thing about us. There are places where we've been stuck for a long time where we say we want to get well, but sometimes it's a good question to ask. There's a question behind the question. Are you really willing to not just experience change, but maybe to change what you're doing, to change your approach? Maybe this guy, this had become his identity. Actually, it could have been a fairly lucrative way to make a living. For 40 years, that's all he had done is ask for the help of others. Maybe he thought, I'm not sure what I would do, so I'm just going to be here. But what he really indicated is he really does want to get well. He just didn't see how it was possible, so he'd kind of given up hope. And I love that Jesus seeks out people who've given up hope. See, it's not just, and a lot of times you'll see it, people seek out Jesus and he engages with them. We'll see it next week in kind of the case study we look at. But you need to understand, even in those examples, Jesus is always the one who's seeking you first. He's your creator. Something valuable has been lost, and it needs to be reclaimed and redeemed. So he asked him this question, do you want to get well? See, that's an important question for you to answer too. Wherever you are in life, if you feel stuck, if you feel overcome, if you have hurts, habits, or hangups that just, you can't seem to break out of that cycle, I think Jesus would ask you that question as well. If there's a forgiveness issue where you have a hard time forgiving somebody, and you go, man, I just wish I could get over this. Do you want to get well? Or do you kind of like holding on to that grudge? Or do you feel like holding on to it kind of as a way to kind of get back at them and let them know you hurt me? So I'm holding on to this. Maybe there's a habit where you say you want to stop, you want to stop, you want to stop, but not enough to admit you need help. Do you want to get well is the question he asked that man, and I think he asked all of us. Here's how the guy replies. Sir, the invalid replied, I have no one to help me into the pool when the water is stirred. See, that statement, if verse 4 wouldn't be there, we'd all going, what does that mean? We don't understand the kind of the background, so that's why the scribe probably thought, they're not going to understand what John's talking about here. They're not locals. I got to tell them. But what this also indicates is this guy was very limited in his thinking. He had no idea who he's talking to. Do you know every time you pray and ask God for help, you have no idea who you're talking to? We greatly reduce and limit God's ability to bring change and hope and help and healing and salvation to anybody and any situation. Resurrecting is what he does. It's who he is. I have no one to help me into the pool when the water is stirred. When I'm trying to get in, someone else goes down ahead of me. We're so limited in our thinking sometimes of how God might help us get well. And we often make excuses. Sometimes it becomes our identity. I'm a victim of what's happened to me. It's not my fault. Do you want to get well? And Jesus doesn't kind of let this deal. He actually never answers the question. But it was God's purpose that was at play here, not just the invalid's purpose. Because again, you were created on purpose and for a purpose, and every day God is working with purpose in your life, seeking you, pursuing you, working in you and around you. I really believe that. And so Jesus asked him, because it's his purpose that's going on here. There's something awkward and uncomfortable he asked the man to do. Because sometimes God asks you to take a step that's awkward and uncomfortable. And that's where the question, do you want to get well, is really tested. I want to get well, but not that bad. I want things to change. I don't want me to change. I just want things to change. So here's what he says. Then Jesus said to him, get up, pick up your mat, and walk. This man had not done that in 38 years. This is an awkward request. But he does it. At once, the man was cured. He picked up his mat and he walked. Often, I believe, if you want to get well, Jesus will ask you to take a step of faith that is awkward and uncomfortable. And you're stepping toward the story God has for your life, toward the purpose he has for your life, and ultimately toward this idea of being made new, of being reclaimed and redeemed. Now, when this happened, again, if you put yourself in the story, there were actually people around. We know that there were other people who were wanting to be healed. Jesus picked one out of the crowd and said, you, do you want to get well? There were other people there. I'm not sure if they were listening or observing what was going on, but some people eventually kind of come into the story. And when you hear that this is what happened and you see this is what happened, for 38 years, this guy had been doing this and now he's walking. This should have been a clue that, hey, maybe Jesus is who he says he is. Maybe this is the Messiah. In Isaiah 35, verses 5 through 6, it actually tells us, hey, the Messiah will come and the lame will walk, the blind will see. Like, this is who the Messiah is. It's who he is. It's what he does. Be looking for this. Here it's happening. And where some people should have seen a miracle, others saw a broken rule. Verse 9, it says this, the day on which this took place was a Sabbath, the holy day, as in the Ten Commandments, honor the Sabbath. And they see it happen. Some people see it happen, and they have a problem with it. And so the Jewish leader said to the man who had been healed, it's the Sabbath. The law forbids you to carry your mat. They don't say, hey, good for you. You're walking. Hey, buddy, I haven't seen you do this in a long time. They didn't even say, hey, have you been faking it? Like that would be one of my questions. Like, man, that's a long time to be committed to this con. Instead, they're going, no, you broke a rule. It's the Sabbath. It belongs to God. Don't carry your mat. You broke a rule. You want to know something interesting? The law doesn't forbid you carrying a mat on the Sabbath. They added that in. In Exodus 20, it says to honor the Sabbath, to keep it holy. And what they became concerned about, leaders over time, is like, how can we make sure people do this? What if we added some practical ways they could live this out, as communicators often do? And suddenly it didn't become a practical suggestion. It became law. There are things you can and cannot do on the Sabbath. If your mule falls in the ditch, you can't get it out. Can't carry your mat. You can't do this. friend of mine's wife works at Sick Kids Hospital. That's the real name of the hospital in Toronto. And they have an elevator called the Sabbath elevator for the Orthodox Jewish community. So on the Sabbath, they don't have to push the button for what floor they want to go to if they need to go see their kid that's sick in the hospital. They get on the elevator, it stops at every floor. Much like it would do when I was a kid and I'd do the Buddy the Elf thing with the buttons. There it's meant serves a purpose. Mine, it was just kind of fun to see all the lights. But because somewhere along the line, these leaders thought, we need to make sure you understand how important this is and how you can't even get close to this. So if it says honor the Sabbath, let me tell you how to do that. This should serve as a warning for us. There is something in us to hear what God wants us to do and hear the thing he tells us, and then all these layers of steps and hoops and boxes to check to make sure it's honored. And then we can kind of say, well, God says to honor the Sabbath. Let me tell you, oh, you're not honoring the Sabbath. You're not honoring, and we do it with all kinds of things that God tells us. Beware of writing your own Bible. I believe that this book has a lot of integrity. I believe it can be trusted. I believe it's God's truth. Don't add to it. As a matter of fact, the same God who told us, behold, I'm making all things new, he said, you could trust what comes from me. Don't add to it. Be very careful about adding layers of what it looks like to follow what God has clearly said. He doesn't need your help necessarily to make it more clear of what's right or wrong. Beware of crafting your own rules. Jesus actually performed 7 miracles on the Sabbath. It wasn't a one-time thing where like, oh, I forgot what day it is. Get up and take your mat. Oh, I forgot it was the Sabbath. He did it 7 times. Sabbath was designed for us because there was a rhythm to our life that we need to push pause. We need margin. We need rest. Because without thoughtful reflection on our Creator, we're going to go in some weird directions and burn out. And Jesus worked on the Sabbath because this is what God wanted him to do that day. Verse 11, it says this. The man replied when the religious leaders were asking, who told you to do this? Because clearly they don't know the law that we made. He replied, the man who made me well said to me, pick up your mat and walk. So they asked him, who is the fellow that told you to pick up your mat and walk? The man who was healed had no idea who it was, for Jesus had slipped away into the crowd that was there. But then, later on, Jesus found him at the temple and said to him, see, you are well again. Stop sinning, or something worse may happen to you. The man went away and told the religious leaders that it was Jesus who had made him well. What does that mean? Stop sinning, or something worse may happen to you. It's kind of cryptic. It kind of feels like a threat, doesn't it? What does that mean? Whenever you get a phrase like that and you're reading the Bible and you kind of go, what does that mean? One, you need to hold it up against elsewhere, what it says elsewhere in Scripture. You don't want to pull this one thing and say, hey, if you keep sinning, just bad things are going to happen. Well, that's karma. It's a little different. That's also you reap what you sow. There's some truth to that too. But what I think what he's saying here to the man is not being able to walk is not your biggest problem. Jesus came into the world because, not because we do things, we sin, but because we have a condition called sin. There's a difference. Sins are the things you do that are bad choices. I think I said this recently. Like sometimes people come and say, hey, is this a sin? Is this a sin? Is this a sin? What they're asking for is, can I do this? Like, can I get away with this? Look, I don't want to add to the law. I don't want to tell you what's the Sabbath and what's not. It says what it says. It doesn't say what it doesn't say. But what it clearly says is every single one of us have a condition called sin. And it's there from birth. We're born as a project that needs to be fixed up, reclaimed, and redeemed. And what we don't need is just a coat of paint, new carpet. We need a new life. That's why Jesus came. That's why he died. And if we did need it, the cross is not necessary. And I think he's telling him, the things in your life, and they're valid things. Like, clearly, Jesus cared about this man being able to walk. He healed him. But I think what he's saying is, this is not your biggest problem. And if you're having challenges with your marriage, I'm so sorry. And I believe God can bring hope and help to that. That's not your biggest problem. If it's challenges with your family and it's not going the way you thought, man, that is a problem. I don't think it's your biggest problem. If there are habit issues where there's habitually doing something over and over again, it's not your biggest problem. And you can get hope in those areas, and it's kind of like fixing a room of the house and the rest is falling apart. Ultimately, every single one of us has to look God in the eye and say, yes, I admit that I need you. I'm a sinner in need of grace. And we don't have to ask, is he going to give it? He's promised he would. The biggest challenge for us is admitting we need it, not talking him into it. He's committed. This is what John tells us about this story. So what happens next? So because Jesus was doing these things on the Sabbath, the Jewish leaders began to persecute him. This is kind of the start of kind of leading up to what would ultimately happen at the cross, where they would put him to death. In his defense, I don't think that's the right word. I think what he's really saying, in explaining who he is, it's not defending what he did, it's defending who he is, his identity. Because this is what he reveals about himself. Jesus said to them, my Father is always at his work to this very day, and I too am working. And it says, for this reason, they tried all the more to kill him, not only because he was breaking the Sabbath, but he was even calling God his own Father, making himself equal with God. See, he wasn't just defending what he did, he's defending who he is. I'm God. I am the resurrection and the life. I am the one who makes dead things come alive and makes new things exist out of nothing. This is who I am because this is what I do because this is who I am. And what he says is he has got his Father and he is always at work. I believe he's at work in your life. Even if you're not pursuing him, I believe he's at work trying to draw you to himself. Even if you're not saying, I want to get well, I believe he's working, trying to lead you that direction. He's always at work in the lives of people because we're created on purpose, for a purpose, and God is at work with purpose every single day. So it's not a question if God is willing to work. He is. The question is, are you willing to let him work in your life? Are you willing to admit that you need to get well, that you need help, that you need to be made new? Real life change has less to do with our willpower, and for many of us, this is where we get stuck. I am gonna try harder, not the best strategy. It's not about willpower. It has less to do with willpower and more to do with your willingness to admit that you can't do it on your own. Why is that so hard for us? Why is it hard to say, I can't do this? I've tried and I can't change. I failed. It's hard. But your willingness to admit that you can't do it on your own and your willingness to surrender your will to Jesus, that is when demo day happens. When your will is broken down and God says, now, my will can not just fix you up, it can help you be made new. The choice we have to make is admit that I need help and admit I need him. You can do half of that, admit I need help, but you also have to admit that you need him, that he's the one as your creator who knows best how you function. As your Savior, the one who died on the cross is the one who can bring grace and hope and help and forgiveness into your life. Admit that you need him. But starting with admitting that you need help, that you want to get well. Real life change starts with, here's a shorter phrase to kind of summarize that. Real life change starts with a new life, not just a new leaf. To go out of here tomorrow and say, I'm just gonna try harder. I'm turning over a new leaf. It's not gonna happen. You can bring some change, but you can't bring ultimate life change. Only God can do that. So let me ask this question. This is what he does, and we see an example of how he did it with this one guy. There were lots of people there that day. I remember one time when I was reading this account and I was doing that, I was putting myself in this story as a participant, I kind of just unknowingly put myself as one of the others who'd gathered there for help. And Jesus doesn't say to everybody, hey, guys, who wants to get well? You're all healed. He didn't do that. He did it with one person. But it told us that there were a great number of people there. Why did he just do it with the one person? It bothered me. I started saying, that's not how I would do things. I mean, you had the power to, I mean, why would you do it this way? Here's the answer. Because this is what the Father was doing that day. Remember verse 19, it says, Jesus gave him this answer. Very truly, I tell you, the Son can do nothing by himself. He can only do what he sees his Father doing. Why did he just heal the one guy? We're not sure what God's thinking is, but for that day, Jesus' one purpose was, I need to go to this place and find that one person. Ask him if they want to get well. And even when he answers the question without answering the question, and he doesn't get who he's talking to, I'm doing something in his life. Why? I have no idea, except he can only do what he sees the Father doing. Because whatever the Father does, the Son also does. That day, Jesus knew he had an appointment with this person. It was a very specific thing. He didn't do it with every invalid. But we also know that where he is at work is that if anyone comes to him, they can be made new. That's the continued, repeated promise in Scripture. It's not a footnote added by a scribe. It's not a one-time phrase where you go, well, that's weird. I wonder what that's doing in there. It's there again, again, and again where he says, anyone, whoever, if anyone comes to me, whoever comes to me, he promises forgiveness, redemption. He says, I will make your life new. That's what his Father is doing every day. On that day, it was an appointment with one person. Today, it's with everyone. It's with you. It's with anyone who would admit they need help and come to him. Why did Jesus just do that one person that day? Because that's what his Father was doing that day. And each and every day, that's what Jesus did. He followed God's lead with all his heart until his heart stopped beating on the cross, and he gave his life for you so he could give his life to you. And if you want God to fix up your life, if you want to be made new, it has everything to do with the heart that stopped beating for you but was given for you so he could give his life to you. And because the tomb was empty 3 days later, resurrecting is what he does because this is who he is. It starts with what he does for us. But your first step is admitting you need it. And it might be as simple as saying, God, I've never owned up to the fact that I'm a sinner who needs to be rescued. I'm a creation who needs to be reclaimed and redeemed and made new. Sin is the condition I have, and sins is what I have done. And because of that, I need a new life from my Savior. I admit that I need it. I believe you did it. And I'll receive it. Jesus asked the question to everybody, do you want to get well? Do you know that you need help? Do you know that you need Jesus? Do you know that Jesus is interested in you, even if you're not seeking him? That man was not seeking Jesus that day. He even calls him that fellow later on. But Jesus was seeking him. Do you know that Jesus is interested in you? Do you know that Jesus, the God of the universe, the creator, who makes things exist out of nothing and dead things come alive, can do something about your situation? That's what he says. It's what I believe. That's what we're counting on. But if your game plan tomorrow is just to turn over a new leaf, that's not what this is about. What this is about is this. Real life change starts with a new life, not just a new leaf. We receive that life and we live from it as our source each and every day. Let's stand for closing prayer. This week, every series, we have a unique scripture engagement plan. There's a bookmark today, and we're going to read through the Gospel of John to start off with. As you read it, put yourself in the story and ask yourself the question, what does this tell me about the new life that Jesus wants to give me and provide for me? Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, there are some in this room who right now have lost hope, and they know they need help. They want to get well, but they may not think it's possible. Father, the more familiar we become with you, sometimes we forget. We take for granted. It becomes routine. The fact that you're in the business of bringing new life, of doing the impossible. And sometimes we think not being able to walk or not being able to see or not being able to hear, things like that, are the most miraculous things we can imagine, because we don't understand the depth of our need for you. This condition of sin that we're born with that has broken us. But you did not turn your back on us. The greatest miracle of all is that you can take a broken life that is broken by sin and make it new. God, thanks for all the ways you're at work in our life, but we greatly underestimate the miracle of salvation. And today, if there's anyone who needs to give their life to you, I pray they would just pray something like this. Father, I admit that I need you. I'm a sinner. I am sinful. Aside from you, I have no hope. But I believe that you died for me, you rose from the dead, and you want to forgive me and give me new life to help reclaim my life and make my dead life come alive and make my heart brand new. So I receive what you've done for me. Father, I pray anyone who right now is desperately in need of your hope and help would walk out of here knowing that our hope is not that we are in our willpower or turning over a new leaf, but it's the new life that only you could give, and they would look to you each and every moment, starting with this one, to receive it. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.